Now, let's look at creating journal entries. We've been talking about the books and the journals. Now, let's actually create an entry. To do that, you go to General Ledger, All, Journal Entries. You can either create a journal entry by clicking the plus sign, or you can come into here and create Add, or you can do View Transactions, go into the actual journal that you want to create the journal in, and click Add. Now, what are the advantages to this? Okay, so let's do it this way. If you click on the plus sign here, or if you're in the whole list and you click on the Add button here, it gets you to the same journal entry page, except you have to choose a journal. Whereas if you slid down into the specific journal you want to post in, you don't have to do that. It's a matter of preference and a matter of error control, whatever your policy is. There's nothing to force you to do one or the other. In this case, we'll just do it at this level. We choose our general journal for this, our posting date, a description, which you see by the little asterisk is required. You can create a comment that stays internal to the entry. It is not seen anywhere else. You can give it a reference number. It can be a job number. It can be anything of your desire. It's a free text field. I think it's about 30, 40 characters long. You can press the little blue dotty line underneath it, and it'll give you a little pop-up. You can enter your own number to identify this transaction. It can be anything. You can add attachments, as we talked about in the attachment entry. Also, if it's some kind of accrual entry, you can set it for an automatic reversal date so that when that date comes, let's say we want it to reverse on August 1st. You put it in, and on August 1st, it'll automatically create a reversal of this entry in order to back it out. We don't want to do that in this case. Now, the journal entry is made up of the header section here, which has your journal, description, posting date, and reference number. When we were looking at the journal entry template, you have the similarly named columns. You have your journal, posting date, which is the date here. I know it doesn't say posting date, but it is the same. Your description, you have your reference number. This set of the templates we call the header section because this is the header section. Now, here is the entries level section, the line items. This is where you enter your actual transactions. If you look at the template, you will see a similar setup. Let me come down here. Now, the order of these columns in the entry are different from the template. That's because you're able to change the order that they show up in. But as you can see, we have account number here, account. Your line number is this here, this 1 and 2. See here, that relates to this line number. Document is a little free text field similar to reference that in this case has been moved below the line. Each row has a show details tab. Opens up and shows all the other dimensions and other options available to you. Because this demo is set up for multi-currency, it has a multi-currency section. You also have your dimensions that you do not have up on the top level, such as customer, vendor, employee, item, and you also have your allocation area in case you want to create a custom allocation. You'll also see an exchange rate. Whenever they created this custom layout, they just moved the dot field down here. This is about 20 characters in length. Many times it's used for check numbers or something else similar. The layout we have up here, I added allocations to it and moved some things around. You do that by going to More Actions, Entries Layout. If you need this done, it's done in order to make it more user-friendly for data entry. Contact your administrator or your implementer to have this layout changed. Is an administrator function. At any rate, so the documents down in the details section, you have your memo over here, your debits and credits, which here is transaction credit and Transaction debit is caused, it is called that in this case because of the various modules we have set up. A lot of times it'll just be debit and credit, just like it's shown here. We also have, let's scroll over. Now, the things in blue are nice to have, but you don't have to have. Everything in yellow is required. And as I told you, even though it says no location is not required, it is. Trust me, it'll error if you don't put it in there. Also have a place for allocations if you're going to use a transaction allocation, not dynamic allocations, but your transactions, which we will cover in a soon coming video. You also have your project or jobs dimension column, task ID, which is cost code in Intacct. For the construction side of Intacct, task ID is construction code. And you also have your dimension cost type. As you can see, we've put them on the line up here. So you can do your project, cost code, cost type, account, department, location, allocations if needed, and your debit and credit and memo. For most of us, that's all we're going to need. But this is where you find it in the template. Now, in the template, you can rearrange these columns so they're more closer together, so you're not having to scroll through the whole thing like this. But that's up to you. Just don't change the headers. Don't change the headers. You can move them and shift them around, but don't change their spelling, or it will error on you. And that's not always an easy error to find if it's a subtle change. Now that we've gone through all that, let's go down here and do an entry. In Intacct, it is double entry, double balancing accounting, meaning for every debit, there must be a credit. For every credit, there must be an offsetting debit or multiples of either. Just so at the end, your total down here is zero. Well, not zero, but the debits match the credits. So first you come in. Let's say you want to choose your job. Maybe you want to choose a cost code. Say coordination. You have to choose a job and a cost code in order to choose a cost type because it's built off of those two things. We'll say it's labor. You can choose your GL account. You can either scroll. If you know the number, you can add the number. If you don't know the number, you can start typing. If you know the first letter, and do it that way. In this case, we're going to do this. We're going to do cost of sales labor. Why? Because it's just what I'm doing. Department, we're going to leave blank. Location, because of dimensional relationships, as I mentioned earlier in an earlier video, when I chose job, location automatically updated. So let me show you. If I choose San Antonio, it auto-filled the location with the San Antonio location. Really big time saver. And you can generally set up those relationships with most things. You don't want to do it with cost codes and cost types because it can vary so much. But you could, but I wouldn't. You come up here, you put in your amount. Let's just call it 1200. You can tab. Now, if you don't give it a memo, it'll auto-populate with your description. Otherwise, you can just type in here whatever you want to call it. I'm too lazy to do anything else, so I'm going to leave it like that. We'll go to Houston. I don't know, maybe we don't have a cost code and cost type for this. Labor. Maybe we want to do it to, let's say, accrued labor, maybe. There we have it, offsetting. We'll come down here to totals. Voila, they match. You can come down here to show details. You see here it has a customer. This customer, it has a dimensional relationship with the project because on the project, this is set as its default customer. That's why it's doing that. And then you post it. You can also, before I do that, you can also hit post and new, which will post this to the GL and the general journal and bring up a new screen. Alternatively, you could save it as a draft if you're not done creating the entry. Draft is kind of a save as, or just a easy save without posting. It doesn't post, it doesn't show up in the books anywhere, it's just as a draft. Let me show you what this looks like. I'll save it as a draft first. Now I need to go into a general journal because I wasn't in there to start with. Now, see, it's in here as a test entry and state of draft. Now, you can change the view to see more information. You could also print it to PDF or Excel to see what the entry looks like. If you need to show it to somebody, maybe for some kind of approval or something. And it comes out like this. It just gives you the line items. It doesn't give you all the rest, the header information. Now, if you're ready to post it, you come here, hit edit, and click post. It'll post, and now it's hit your general ledger books. You can also click edit and look at the history. See when it was created as a draft, and then post. I edited it and then posted. And then also, let's see, view sometimes shows us something different. No, it's not going to this time. That's for AP and AR only. You also get your audit trail here. And it gives you a little bit more detail of what's happened on this entry. So you can always see what's going on. Done. And then we can go to the general ledger. I don't suppose we remember what GL account I used. We're going to look current month. Let's do it as a date of 31/2/2. We will discuss this report more in depth at a later time. Cost of goods, labor. And let's do view. Come in here, and there it is. General journal, Houston location, $1,200. Anything in blue can normally be clicked down on and drilled into. What you drill into may be different, but in the general ledger report, you click on the view, it takes you into the entry itself, and here gives you the entry that was created. Okay. That's the basics of the journal entries and how to create one. There are a few other things that we can go into later, but that's going to be more advanced, and this gets you started. Next, we're going to look at, I believe, statistical journals and then recurring journals. All right.